is the sort of background kind of assumptions that underlay all of my work, and it's something that you all are very familiar with, so I won't spend a lot of time on it. It's, you know, a basic model for how the connection between usage level events with individual people, how you can get some sort of causal, indirect causal mechanism that goes from those individual events all the way to long-term sound change. That's a very, very long and indirect and very complicated causal chain, but we have lots of evidence that there is such a chain. And I'll show you more of that evidence today. But the basic idea is that you have biases in the phonetic form of some word token, that feeds back eventually to create changes in the prototypical, sort of the exemplar cloud, if you will, of that word token, that word form, which then spreads over time and through a community into the lexicon at large. And there's another sort of picture that I often use for this, where you have, on the one hand, over here, you've got biases on phonetic forms of tokens, and there's a jillion different possible ways that biases can sneak in. And provided that listeners and speakers are able to register differences, theoretically, biases can come from anywhere. So this kind of model is a little more reminiscent of evolution and biology, in that, you know, the theory of natural selection doesn't say where the selection has to come from, and it admits selection from anywhere. And then it becomes incumbent upon the researcher, makes it more difficult for a researcher to actually pin down models because the models are so open-ended. Relative to example, an example of the opposite extreme, a very hard-edged universal grammar type model, like OT, for example, some versions of OT that have very, very crisp predictions and single-level explanations. The explanation for all the patterns can only come from this one very narrow set of phenomena. It's very easy to test your hypotheses. Of course, very often your hypotheses get disproved. So then you get biases, changes in word form variance, and changes across the lexicon. And the thing that I started getting really interested in, because of course, as I mentioned, just as in evolutionary biology, if you want to test your models, you have to find good natural experiments, contexts in which you can ask questions where the potential hypotheses and the potential results are more constrained. Because if you've got a model which admits so many different sources of bias, you have a difficulty in that you have so many moving parts to your model that you can almost explain anything. That doesn't mean that the model's not right. It means it's harder to find ways to test it effectively. So I stumbled upon one a number of years ago, and it turned out to be something of a gold mine. And that was the notion that there are influences on phonetic form that arise through some putative bias towards accurate transmission of lexical information. In other words, that there's an influence from the lexicon on the shape of words. And the thing that's great about that is that that's going to be different for different languages. One thing that everybody agrees on is that the lexicon phonology mapping is, if not random, it's close to random. And that's going to be different for different languages, and it's also something that's relatively easily measured. You can get at least coarse measures for lots of lexical phenomena from different languages easily. So, great test case for things. So that's what I've worked on for quite a while now. So a basic question that's been asked for virtually a century now is whether the functional load of a phoneme contrast influences its trajectory of change. More specifically, the kind of question that's been asked for the last century is, if you've got two phonemes, if you've got a phoneme contrast in a language, does the amount of work that that phoneme contrast does in transmitting information influence how stable that contrast is going to be throughout language change? As an example, the ah-ah distinction in English, so lot thought. For probably most of you, if you're from anywhere west of about Kansas or if you're from Canada, you don't have that distinction at all, the thing that's written with the backward C and the ah. That is merged in many varieties of North American English. And various measures of how much work that contrast does suggest that actually it doesn't do very much work. In contrast, a measure of vowel pair like I and E, this is a crappy vowel contrast. These vowels are this close. Even native speakers make mistakes all the time, and non-native speakers are like, what the heck? People, why are you having this vowel contrast? And yet, we don't, native varieties of English do not merge that vowel contrast. And by many measures, that vowel contrast does an enormous amount of work in distinguishing words. So we've got sort of, people have noticed this for the last century, that there seems to be some sort of correlation here. People have had, however, an enormously difficult time testing it. And the reason is the following. So previous work has involved just case studies, because that's all the information that people had access to. So the basic strategy was, find a phoneme merger or a set of mergers in a language or two languages, and you assess the change in the system given whatever your favorite measure of functional load is. And that's been another difficulty, of course, is in the basic intuition about amount of work. It's easy to sort of state that over a beer, but it's a lot harder to get down and say, actually, how are we going to really count that? Then it becomes very messy very quickly. So you have some measure, you assess the change in the system once that merger has happened, and then you have to compare that to some set of phonemes that have not merged. Because you assess the change in the system and you get some number, you get some answer, and you don't know whether that's big or small. So you have to compare it to other things and hope that the fact that they hadn't merged was actually significant, and then get some number.
Right.
And then you ask, is the change in the system smaller for the actual mergers than the non-mergers? And there you go. And the problem has been when you have a case study system like this, where you just have a limited number, any given languages don't lose phoneme contrasts every day. So if you find some particular language with a couple of phoneme mergers, you've only got two or three data points. So the problem is, I mean, people have been trying this for the last century, but they've gotten two or three data points at a time, and so nobody's really been able to say anything much. And some of my coworkers and I realized about 5 or 6 years ago that, wait a minute, now we have big databases and we've got computers and we can do statistics and things like this. So we realized that we could ask the question potentially more intelligently. So let me just go through a couple of different approaches to operationalizing functional load. So people have looked at it at the level of the phoneme inventory. So just, for example, what's the phoneme level entropy change? Lots of people looked at that. And at the level of the lexicon. So Surendran and Niyogi made a large point of saying that really you need to be measuring entropy, because that's a way to get frequency into the mix, and frequency must matter. But you can also just do sort of the easiest, most stupid way to do it, and that is just to look at minimal pairs. And Uriel Cohn-Cregan has looked at cohorts. So looking at, I'm actually not going to explain that because I don't want to take too much. I'm going to try to get to the Melissa part as quickly as possible. All right, so we got a big database. So we found 9 languages for which we could get good data. What we wanted was a phonemic transcription of the language. We wanted a lemma level transcription, so we wanted stems, not inflected forms, and we needed frequency information, and we wanted a bunch of mergers that had happened diachronically recently. So for example, I don't want to get frequency information for English about a merger that happened 800 years ago, right? So we looked for changes that we thought had happened in that language or in the dialect of that language within the last 100 or 150 years or so, so that the date that we have for right now is at least close. All right, so we ended up with 714 phoneme pairs, of which 55 were mergers. I'll talk about the shifts and the splits in a moment. And we tried a bunch of different things. Let me just show you briefly what we found. So we tried all sorts of, basically it was a fishing expedition. We asked, can we find any measure of a functional load that we can find, that we can get with this data? Is there anything that is significantly predictive? Interestingly enough, it was the simple measure that was the one that was really predictive, and that was number of minimal pairs. So right here on the y-axis, we've got the minimal pair count, the phoneme pairs in the database that have not merged are on the left, and those that have merged are on the left. And that was a very significant difference. There's on average like less than 26 or so minimal pairs for things that have merged, and many more for those that have not merged. What kind of minimal pairs? We were able to ask that. So what we've looked for, well, does lemma versus word form matter? And yes. The data was good enough to show that the lemma form was much more significant, was a much better descriptor of the data than the word form. Interestingly, we were also able, because this was these were morphologically marked databases, we could split up our minimal pair counts between within syntactic category minimal pairs, so like noun-noun minimal pairs, versus minimal pairs that cross categories, so a noun-verb minimal pair, for example, or an adjective-noun minimal pair. And what we found is that it was only the within-category minimal pairs that were accounting for the data. These, of course, are quite closely correlated, but they're not so correlated that we couldn't distinguish them within the data. And of course, there's a giant neon caveat over all of this, and that is this is this data set. So it was a fishing expedition, so it has to be repeated at some point. But it has to be. The other thing that was really interesting, we looked very, very hard for any frequency effect, and we could not find any frequency effect anywhere. Now, again, a caveat, we're using modern corpora of varying quality and genre to assess frequency. And for many of these mergers, they may have started 150 years ago or 200 years ago when the frequency relationships could have been different. So the fact that we didn't find any frequency effects could be because the data is crappy. But interestingly, I would be surprised if the frequency relationships now are completely unrelated to the frequency relationships 100 years ago. And one thing that we really looked for, this is not in the published, or if it is, if it's in the published versions, it's in a footnote. One thing that we really looked for was whether or not we would find a smaller role for minimal pairs where at least one of the members of the minimal pair was low frequency. And the reason we were interested in that is, do we have any evidence that children are doing this as opposed to adults? If kids are doing this, you would expect that kids have smaller vocabularies, and of course what's going to fall out is the low frequency members of the minimal pairs. In other words, for people with smaller vocabularies, some of those minimal pairs are not minimal pairs, don't have minimal pairs because they don't have one member or both, depending on what the frequencies are. And what we could not find any lesser effect for the minimal pair counts that just focused on counts where one of the members was low frequencies. If that's, to the extent that we can take that seriously, that suggests that these effects are being driven by adult usage over a lifespan, as opposed to things that happen during acquisition of phonology in childhood. Okay, that's just a little freebie. I don't stand behind that. That's just there. Okay, so just for some example model predictions that lead us into the next bit. This is just the probability of merger predicted by the final statistical model, and it gives the ah merger in American English a reasonable probability of merging. In contrast, vowel pairs like e, I, I, e, 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 it gives them a zero probability of merging. They have so many minimal pairs that they distinguish that are within category, it says, no, never going to happen. And in fact, that's what we see. We don't see dialects of English that are not driven by contact effects that merge these vowels. In fact, what we find instead is that those particular vowels are continuously engaged in chain shifts. So that was the second thing that we asked. We asked, what about changes in phoneme inventories that might actually betray the attempt of phoneme pairs to avoid merging? So we looked at phoneme shifts, so vowel shifts, for example, they also occur in consonants, and phoneme splits, where you have a merger of a primary contrast and a concomitant expanding of a subsidiary contrast into an intermediate contrast. So within the same data set that we had, we already had quite a large number, not as many mergers, but we had a number of shifts and splits that were attested in the literature. So we threw them in. And what we found was, interestingly, the opposite. So this is, again, minimal pair count on the y-axis. These are the phoneme pairs that have merged in the data set. These are all the things that haven't changed, by which I mean nobody has written anything about them saying that they've done one thing or another. It's all just the rest of the phoneme pairs. And these are the phoneme pairs that have engaged in a shift or a split. And you can see that they have dramatically higher minimal pair count. And just because it's a gorgeous graph, I'm going to show you just looking at this column and these two put together. In other words, if I tell you I have a phoneme pair, it has either undergone a merger, which is the kind of change that collapses lexical distinctions, or it's undergone a shift or a split, which is the kind of change to the phoneme inventory, changes something, but it preserves lexical distinctions. Words that were different before the change are still different after the change. And I'm going to tell you how many minimal pairs. Can you guess which kind of a change it is? And this is what that looks like. So now we've got minimal pair count on the y, on the x-axis here. And then this is just the density of the data. The red are the mergers, the blue are the shifts and the splits. It's a near categorical distinction. In other words, it so happens in this data, the number of minimal pairs, just the raw number of minimal pairs, accounts for 80% or more of the variance in that data, which is exciting. And that suggests that at least for languages like these that are very analytic, these are, of course, big languages, Korean, English, German, things like this, but that have got nice, robustly distinct morphemes and stems where you can find different, you know, you find edges. So it's easy to count minimal pairs. For at least those, minimal pair count seems to do a good job in predicting what kinds of changes occur, at least at this level. All right, so given the model that I showed you before, you know, where we've got biases on word tokens, moving into word forms, moving into phonemic and all phonological systems, I've just shown you that there's some cross-linguistic evidence for a minimal pair effect influencing things that are going on over here. But this sort of model predicts that that's going to have to be related to something, some way that minimal pairs interact with one another in usage. So now we went looking for that, and other people have looked at for it before, of course. So what we're going to look for is an evidence for a minimal pair effect in word-level hyperarticulation. All right. So more generally, looking for what we're calling contrastive hyperarticulation. Mohalla called it that back in the 90s, which is then in contrast to, so to speak, for more generic slow speech, clear speech hyperarticulation, the kind of hyperarticulation I'm doing now because I'm trying to be globally understood. And the question is do we find something specific that's about actual lexical competition? And the big question that we're interested in is how phonetically specific does the competition need to be? What's the best measure for competition? The data that I just showed you suggested that minimal pairs matter. Do more broader, coarser, more general kinds of competition matter as well? So, for example, neighborhood density. And under what conditions do we expect the hyperarticulation to be apparent? Does the competitor need to be contextually available for it to happen? And I'll return to this later. Does hyperarticulation, is that subject to ceiling effects? So there's lots of previous work and lots of interesting findings that have gone before, and I'm not going to go through those because I want to get someplace more interesting for the moment really quickly. But a lot of people have worked on the VOT of voiceless initial stops in elicited speech, among them Melissa and colleagues. And there's been a lot of different kinds of findings. So people have found that neighborhood density matters, People have found that onset neighborhood density matters. People have reported that stop voicing minimal pair. So if you're a P, do you have a B initial minimal pair? And it's gone back and forth. And there's a lot of, I think Melissa would say it's a little bit messy. And I hope that I have something to contribute to that. I think maybe I do. The other thing that people have looked at a lot is vowel dispersion in elicited speech. Vowel dispersion is how big is the vowel space, and it's often measured as distance of a vowel token from the center of the vowel space. And many people have reported that greater neighborhood density is correlated with an expanded vowel space production. Although there's been, again, it's complicated. There are various people who have found other things as well. So we're going to look at a cross set of questions. So how specific is this trigger for contrastive hyperarticulation? And we're going to specifically compare Q-specific minimal pair competitor existence and an example of a very non-specific measure, which is just neighborhood density. Now, there are a lot of different ways to actually measure it. Does a competitor exist or not? A minimal pair competitor exist? Does it exist or not? There are lots of different ways to measure neighborhood density. It comes down to making a lot of hard choices, and I'd be happy to talk about exactly the choices we made. And in fact, we tried it a bunch of different ways to make sure that our initial first, we did it, we ran our models, we picked our best guesses of how to measure these things, and then we went back and tried a bunch of others to make sure that we didn't accidentally pick ones that gave us particular results, to make sure that our results were robust, and they were pretty robust. They were actually very robust, and I will tell you more about that if you like. And then specifically, how specific is the outcome of hyperarticulation? Specific would be movement away from a competitor, so that the outcome of hyperarticulation is specifically about being more perceptually distinct from whatever the competitor was, versus a more generic expansion of the space. And for at least some kinds of the hyperarticulation that we're looking at, those are in different directions, so we can actually ask that question. So we looked in the Buckeye corpus. Instead of using elicited speech, we had other laboratory reasons for suspecting that when you use elicited speech, in other words, speech that is already clear and slow, it's harder to find these effects, or it may be harder to find these effects. So we actually looked in reduced speech. So we again asked about neighborhood density, existence of minimal pair competitor, and we decided, okay, let's go for it. Let's try to assess a bunch of different measures. And so we put in a lot of work. So we got the VOT for word initial stops, both voiced and voiceless, and we got F1, F2 Euclidean distance in vowels. Especially getting voiced VOT, because voiced VOTs are tiny. They're sometimes zero. What this entailed was doing it all by hand. So we got all of the voiceless VOTs and all the voiced VOTs by hand, which took many months and ate many undergraduate souls. The F1, F2, Euclidean distance and vowels we got automatically. Let me just go through this quickly. So, for the VOTs and word initial stops, we went through, we used 24 out of the 40 speakers in the Buckeye because we simply could not do all 40. We ran out of life force. We got words, content words that started with PTK or BDG. They were all one or two syllables. We did not look at anything that was preceding or a following utterance or this fluency boundary. And we wanted to get the length of the stop closure as well. So we avoided words that followed a final a stop, you know, so that we could actually get the whole closure. So we measured the closure and the burst lengths. So just as a quick example of what that is, here's just a little example of me saying a P, a B. This is the VOT, this is the total length of the stop, and here you can see the smaller one for B. That's classic, that's what clear speech looks like. This is what an example of what we measured in the Buckeye. Here's the word care, and we went through and marked out the approximate start of the closure, the start of the following sonorant, and the beginning of the aspiration. And we went into this for thousands of words. This is what the data looks like. So this is the VOT, the aspiration length at the top for B and P, D and T, and K and G. We also, as it for the stats that I will show you, what we looked at was actually the ratio of the VOT to the total stop length as a internally normalized way to look at VOT, because VOT expands and contracts in speech rate. But let me just show you the raw data, what it looks like with divided up by minimal pair existence or not. This is the basic finding right here. So here we have the voice stops. Let me take you through this. So the y-axis in both cases, the VOT, you can see it goes up to 80 for the voice stops, up to 150 or so for the voiceless stops. And we have B, D, G, these are bean plots. The light blue are words without a corresponding minimal pair. So for example, in this light blue, we have words like badge, where padge is not a real word. And the purple, these are words that do have a minimal pair. So this would be words like bat, where there is a word pat. And you can see, look for B here, the VOT is lower, is shorter for the B words that have a P minimal pair versus the B words that don't have a minimal pair. See the same thing for D, same thing for G. And what we see here is the opposite pattern for P, T, and K. And so the P, T, and K looks really good. It turns out that's barely significant. The B, D, G is super significant, but the P, T, K is almost this is the one effect that we found that was not super robust, even though it visually looks good. We did linear mixed effects modeling. We used as our factors of interest stop voice and minimal pair competitor existence, neighborhood density, and of course there's a vast number of things in between those two. We just marked out sort of the most coarse and the most sort of specific measure of lexical competition, and then a whole bunch of control factors. And I can go through these with you if you're interested. The basic model form looked like this, with our factors of interest, control factors, and then a random effect structure with the factors of interest as random slopes on speaker. And we used the Lemoine. These are all based on Lemoine forms, stem forms. And just to give you an example, here is an output for the voice stop model. So, see the neighborhood density, minimal pairs is significant. Neighborhood density was not significant. We never found neighborhood density to be significant. And it's in the existence of a minimal pair predicts a smaller VOT. And we get the opposite for the voiceless stops. As you can see, it's not nearly significant, it's 0.03. We tried a bunch of different versions of these. For all but one of them, this was the pattern. For one of them, minimal pair existence was at 0.06 or something like this. Neighborhood density was never significant, no matter the various different measures that we used. It was not significant, but minimal pair existence was, and I actually have a suspicion about that, and I can tell you about that later, what's going on. I want to talk to you. This is the part that I'm proud of. I mean, I'm proud of this, but this is the part that I'm very proud of, because, how could we look for hyperarticulation in vowels? This was the thing that we really wanted to do and was not straightforward. And we spent, I'd say, 2 years thrashing about trying to figure out how to do it. And I think we figured out that we've got something that feels okay. So one of the big questions is dispersion the right measure for contrastive hyperarticulation in vowels? That's been the classic measure forever. Lindblom back in this, Lilienkranz and Lindblom back in the 70s, they already started talking about dispersion, and it seems like people have just taken that ball and run with it and never stopped to ask whether it should be the right one. But remember, I'm a phonologist by training, and and I'm coming at this from language change, and especially based on the evidence that I showed you at the beginning, where minimal, there looks like there's a connection between minimal pair existence and the trajectory of sound change over time. And of course, this sort of hyperarticulation would be a great linchpin to connect those two things. But if that's the case, then dispersion doesn't make sense. And why doesn't it make sense? It doesn't make sense because centralizing vowel shifts happen. So here's just an example, the New Zealand vowel shift. So a has raised all the way to what is my e. E has raised all the way up to what is my e. And I got out of the way by centralizing. So I in New Zealand English is pronounced in the same place as my wedge, as my a. So this number is pronounced sucks. You know, this I bought sucks fushes. And if these vowel shifts are being driven by lexical competition, and lexical competition in vowels can only result in expansion, you should never be able to get a centralizing shift via lexical competition. And centralizing shifts are not the most common. You know, most of the time, vowel shifts move around the vowel space, and you know, at the edges they diphthongize. But there are a number of cases where they centralize. So the Northern City shift also has a centralizing shift for e moving in. So at that point, that told me, okay, dispersion is, people have had a hard time finding interest, you know, consistent things with dispersion based on word density or other things. And maybe it's because dispersion is actually not something that happens with contrastive hyperarticulation. It may well happen with, it certainly happens with clear and slow speech hyperarticulation. When people slow down and they try to speak more clearly, things absolutely disperse more. But it's not clear that clear speech hyperarticulation and contrastive hyperarticulation are the same thing. So that's sort of a leitmotif of where we've been driven over the last couple of years for this. So how could we look for this? We could try competitor vowel Euclidean distance. Now there are like so many problems with this. So potential problems. Vowels are really just, you know, this is an incredibly coarse measure. Just getting an average F1, F2 value for a vowel is, well, people will complain. And our response was, we'll try it anyway. the bigger problem, in this particular case, you know, if you find a good result for it, it's unlikely to have been from something else. If you don't find, as with so many things that we all do as linguists, where we have so many indirect measures, if you fail to find an effect, you don't know anything because your method may have just been not able to detect what you were looking for. Given the complexity of what we're looking for in general, if you do find an effect, it's liable not to be by chance. It still could be, but you have some. So that's one of the reasons why we get to pay. But one of the other problems is that there's always massive co-articulation effects from segmental context, which is one of the reasons that people like to use elicited speech, which is because then at least you have a prayer of controlling for segmental contexts and whatever you're looking for. Now, if it turns out that as soon as you have a lot of clear speech hyperarticulation, you don't see the contrastive hyperarticulation as well, then we're all kind of screwed, because we can either control the data or we can have reduced speech, but it's hard to have both. And we're busy working on a paradigm with a computer game where we're trying to have our cake and eat it too, trying to get people to say the same words over and over again, but fast and excitedly in the laboratory, and we'll see how that's working. But, okay, so our response, we have a particular response to that, and I think it worked well. So, this is just an example. We use just the front vowels, because these are the vowels that participate in chain shifts a great deal in cross-linguistically in English, and they also have lots of different minimal pairs. So in the data. So this is just one of the Buckeye people's vowels, and these are just approximate places for the front vowels for this person, including that. So how are we gonna look? We're gonna get the vowel competitor vowel Euclidean distance. We automatically got the F1 and F2 for initial syllable stressed vowels from one or two syllable content words. And then once we got all of these tokens for every single person, we got the average position for F1 position for all of the vowels. So we've got two different sets of numbers. So for a given person, for this person, for each one of those E tokens, for example, for S16, I've got the F1 and F2 for that token. I've also got the average F1 and F2 for all the other vowels. And what I'm going to do then is get the Euclidean distance from a given token to three of the nearby vowels, the closest vowels. So here's an example. So let's say I've got the token ship for some person, and I'm going to measure the F1, F2 distance from that token of ship to the average E position for that person. All right, and then I'm going to ask, is there a minimal pair in E for ship? Yes, there is, because sheep exists. So I've got a factor, and I will code it as true for that token. Now, when we started initial model building, we found that there was an effect of neighborhood density. Oddly enough, it went the opposite direction. Neighborhood density, the higher the neighborhood density, the closer the vowels were. And we puzzled about that for a little while, and then we said, wait a minute, neighborhood density is going to be... One of the problems that people have noticed before is that trying to look at position and vowel spaces between vowels relative to minimal pairs is the problem that for many, many words, you've got words everywhere, competitors everywhere. So for example, for the word pit, well, there's the word peat, there's the word pet, there's the word pat, there's the word cut. So what do you predict about how you're going to hyper-articulate pit? Because it can't go anywhere. Well, neighborhood density, of course, is correlated with whether or not you've got other vowel competitors. So we decided, okay, well, let's try to code for that, given the data that we already have. And we just said, okay, well, we're going to make a new sort of post hoc factor for, do you have a minimal pair in one of the other two vowels that's nearby? We call that nearby competitor. And so, for example, in this case, because shape exists, we're going to code that as true. We code it true if either one of them or both have a minimal pair. Now, how do I decide which vowel I'm going to measure to? Well, we just measure to all three. So then we get three rows for every token. So I'm going to have ship measure to E, to A, to E. And I can't, of course, include that all in the same data set because I've got multiple measures from the same token, so I just randomly divide it up. So I've got three basic subsidiary data sets out of the whole thing. In one case, my measure is going to be from ship to sheep, in the other from ship to shape, in the other from the ship to ship, right? And coding minimal pair and nearby competitor accordingly. And I randomly split the data apart into three this way, dividing everything up as evenly as possible while doing it randomly. And then we just picked one of the data sets at random to do the model building on. We just picked this one. Okay. And then this is basically what the numbers look like, how many tokens we have to each guy. This is what the data looks like. So this is specific. I will tell you what this data is. This is scaled vowel-vowel distance, so it's the z-score, so that it all fits into one line, basically. And again, and it's only the tokens that have a minimal pair or don't have a minimal pair the competitor vowel vowel that we're measuring to. They all have their nearby competitor value is zero for all of them. So we're only looking at the words that either do or do not have a minimal pair in the vowel that we're measuring to, and they don't have anything else going on. So a word like pit is not in here. And this will become clear. So the light blue are the words that do not have a minimal pair in the competitor vowel, and the purple are the ones that do have a competitor vowel. And you can see the distance is consistently greater if they have a competitor in the minimal pair competitor in the vowel that you're measuring to. All right. And then this is what the data looks like without going into detail. You can see the minimal pair competitor, that's very significant. It's a very, very significant effect. Having a competitor in one of the other vowels is moderate, it's significantly associated with a smaller distance, because on average you've got somebody that's over on some other side, and neighborhood density isn't significant. And there were various other things that were slightly significant. Now, what we then did is we cross-validated, quote unquote, between the three data sets. So why do I put quotes around there? These observations between these three data sets aren't entirely independent because they're based on the same tokens, but all the measures are different because we're measuring to a different vowel, and then of course the minimal pair and the nearby competitor values change. And what we find is, so we use exactly the same model that we built on data set one, we just ran it on data set two and three to ask what we got, and they're all the same. So minimal pair competitor is very significant for all of them. Nearby competitor is significant for all of them in the other direction, and neighborhood density was not significant for any of them. What about vowel dispersion? Hold on 1 second, I'm almost done. What about vowel dispersion? We measured Euclidean distance to this vowel center, space center, and we found no correlation with anything interesting. It's correlated with all the other things that you'd expect, like vowel length, speech rate, but it's not correlated with neighborhood density, which fits with some work that's been done with the Buckeye Bog by Susanna Gall and colleagues. Concluding thoughts. I wonder, this is one of the things that we're wondering, if clear and slow speech hyperarticulation may impose something of a ceiling that makes contrastive hyperarticulation, at least for minimal pair competitors, harder to detect. So the way we're thinking about it, you know, contrastive hyperarticulation may be better thought of as contrastive failure to reduce as much as expected. What's the relationship, if any, to the well-studied effects of neighborhood density on hyperarticulation in elicited speech? There's rich, rich evidence that neighborhood density is involved with certain kinds of hyperarticulation, at least in elicited speech. What's going on there? Does it have any relationship to this? I don't know. And finally, for all of the work that I've just shown you, how seriously should I take minimal pair as a thing, as a real thing? Is that a reified part of language processing, or is it just a particularly close measure to some other actual variable that's in the background? And I want to note that for English and for all the other languages that I studied in the earlier part, these are all big languages that are very analytic, where, you know, a morpheme is a morpheme and it has edges. And there are, of course, many, many languages where morpheme edges are not as crisp. And for those, you're not going to be able to count minimal pairs in the same way because they're not going to have edges that only need to be counted. How are we, what's going to be going on with those? That's just an open question, and that's exciting place for somebody to go. All right, and then with that, I will stop. Thank you very much.